identified the need to do more regarding women from different minorities, and they're talking about religious and ethnic and other aspects as well. But I think the attempt here to move forward, there's been a lot of concern among local civil society who've raised their voices regarding the forced conversions and marriages taking place in Pakistan. And there's been attempts, unfortunately, which have not succeeded so far, in bringing about legislation to deal with this. And on this topic, then, I would like to ask Peter Jacob to come and tell us a little about where the bill is today, what happened, what he thinks is the reasons this did not go through as we move towards Pakistan specifically. Thank you, Peter. Peter is an activist, longtime activist, human rights activist, and for minorities, a longtime colleague in the struggle for human rights for all.
Thank you so much, Farida, for this generous introduction. Members of the panel and everyone, good morning. I would like to begin by my appreciation for the organizers of this conference who have turned the living memory of struggle of Asma Jahangir into an event that will go a long way in collecting, bringing the activists and defenders of human rights together to impress upon the issues that we still face as challenges, as the title of the conference goes. My second observation, because we were talking about the bill, Farida has indicated, she has pointed out to a definition of forced conversion, which can be elaborated again, but she has very wisely given me a topic on the bill, which was somehow turned down, rejected, dismissed, was the language used by a parliamentary committee on the forced conversions. Now, this marks the turning down, basically, of recognition, the short-lived recognition that came about the problem. The rest of the time, there was a long denial that there were any issues with regard to freedom of religion and particularly forced conversions. With this rejection of the bill of a committee which was formed by the two houses and across the parties, across the faith communities, across gender, actually was a sabotage of the agenda of people's protections. It goes without saying that I don't recall in past 20 years when the Parliament of Pakistan discussed the serious question of religious freedom. On the other hand, it has time and again passed resolutions and legislation which goes to restrict the religious freedom, whether it is in the form of cybercrime laws, blasphemy laws, and many other resolutions which go to constitute, not only constitute, but perpetuate a preferential treatment of my majority, but conversely, everybody, discrimination against everybody. Now, with this bill, what happened was that the criminal element who organized in an organized manner perpetrated forced conversions of young girls from Sindh and Punjab mainly, but not limited to these provinces. That is the data which Center for Social Justice showed by analyzing 162 cases up to 2020. But this rejection of the bill also emboldened the criminal element, and that is why in the ongoing year we have a spike. We see a spike in reported cases of forced conversions. So far there have been 38 cases reported this year. Now, whatever we hear from the parliamentary committee, which was a great sabotage, I must say, and we can recognize We know the elements who forcibly and arrogantly, I must say, rejected the bill. We also that it killed the hope for better Pakistan for some time until activists like yourselves revived that strength and spirit to fight against the injustice. I would also like to point out that while we have made our parliament redundant and the committees, human rights committees, and it is not without notice that the functional committee of the Senate on human rights was turned into a standing committee, which meant curtailing the powers of that committee. I would also like to mention here that we need to see what competence and jurisdiction those committees and some of the institutions that were involved. Now, my due respects to Dr. Qibla Ayaz and his institution, the Council of Islamic Ideology. I must say that legally speaking, constitutionally speaking, the Council of Islamic Ideology had any jurisdiction with regard to forced conversions of minor girls is a question. And that is why it is not only a question of jurisdiction. I must also stress that Ministry of Religious Affairs, which has been part of the problem rather than solution, has failed to show any impartiality on this. That is why they have not shown their impartiality on this, and that is why the inquiry into the matter was half-baked, was half-hearted. It never brought the facts to the light which would guide us, which would guide the nation as to how to solve this problem. The professional competence of the committee itself is manifest in the report, which lacks basically the data. So when the committee members said that they did not find any evidence of forced conversions, my question is, where did they look for the evidence? They did not look at the evidence. There are court verdicts, there are prosecution records, there are records of the Darul Amans, and there are victims, basically, some of whom were speaking before this conference. We showed their witnesses with their, of the victims and their families. So I would say that we need to come out of this denial, first of all, and secondly, address the matter objectively. Where in the world have the human rights abuses been ignored this long? It has been a story of 70 plus years. The forced conversions were earliest complained by the first law minister, Joginder-Nath Mandal, and on and on. And that is why I would say, you see this short-lived recognition by the government of the problem needs to be investigated in objective manner and then brought to the House to make it into a legislation that would put a permanent stop to not only forced conversions but all violations against freedom of religion or belief. Am I